Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries.
So who are you, and what is your relationship to the giant schnauzer?
Okay, my name is Sylvia Hammarstrom of Skansen Kennel, and we are located up in Sebastopol, California, which is Northern California, about an hour north of San Francisco in the wine country, Sonoma County. And my relation to the giants are that I've been breeding these dogs since I was 10 years old, which is 70 years ago. I bred my first champions, and I was very lucky to emigrate to United States in 1960. I came with the idea to work for 6 months and see the country, and I'm still here, and I love it, and I'm an American citizen now, and I'm very proud of that.
Nice. What makes giant schnauzers so special?
The schnauzer, there are three sizes, and the most common in Europe is what we call the standard schnauzer. It's a very, very old breed. It goes back 400 or 500 years, and it's been documented in paintings, so it's a fact. And what happened is the Germans and European farmers, they needed somebody or some help with rats. They didn't have rat poison like we have today, so they needed something to keep the rat population down, being that they were farms and they had grains and they had lots of rats. And they found that the schnauzer was the perfect size, and he was very good at doing it, as good as a cat. Cats would have a hard time with big rats. So that's how the breed came about. And very, very popular in Europe, particularly in Germany, and to this day, because today it makes a very good apartment dog. It's the right size, kind of medium, in the range of 40, 50 pounds. But the farmers then realized they wanted something a little bigger, so that when they went to market with their goods, which is, you know, their produce, and they were not always rich enough to have horses, so they have dogs. And they found that if they used a schnauzer and they got him a little bigger, then he could pull the merchants to the market. And then once they sold their chickens and grains, and they went to the pub, they could leave the money in a little bag next to the dog, and nobody would take their earnings, and because they are excellent guard dogs. And so that's how the giant came about. And then, of course, there were going to be a subsection of people who wants a small one, and so they bred them down, and so they also developed what we call the miniature schnauzer, which is a great little guard dog because he makes good noise, and he is a nice lap dog as well. So there is the reason for the three breeds. But they all started with the standard schnauzer.
What did they include into the standard schnauzer to get them to the giant schnauzer?
To get the breed up in size, they used Dobermans. So you would see in the way back when, you would see black and tan giant schnauzers. Then used Great Danes, the black Great Danes, and that's how they, I think, established the color. They also used poodles, the standard poodle, because of its intelligence, the coat, the protective coat for the weathers. And the schnauzer has a little bit of the poodle characteristic. He loves water, just like most poodles do. And they, of course, the intelligence of the standard poodles. So those are most the breeds. Then probably some local breeds, herding breeds, the Bouvier background, breeds like that. But mainly it was Great Danes. They think perhaps a greyhound or two. They're very athletic. and then the poodle for the dark hair or the protective coat.
And so, how do schnauzers at herding? Are they good herders?
Yes, they're excellent herders. In fact, I think that's a drawback to a personal pet because they have a tendency to herd and chase down things, which most breeds do, of course. But they do very, very well at herding tests. They're can be used for sheep herding. They have a tremendous endurance. So they're what we consider a very athletic dog. People who run marathons and like to practice and likes to go out and do their, you know, practice runs, they often feel like they need a protection, and so the Giant makes a great marathon dog.
Real quick, so you work as an AKC judge?
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about your history in judging AKC shows.
Well, when you've been breeding dogs for a very long time, it comes a time when you think that you should be telling other people how to breed. And I got asked in many countries all over the world because I had been selling these puppies, my Giants, to as far away as India, to Hong Kong, and to Korea, Japan, South America, Argentina, South Africa, all the countries in Europe, England. And so these people consider me an expert, and they asked me to come and judge. And so to judge, I had to pass the test for the American Kennel Club. And so that's how it got started. With my judging career, I asked for the permission, and then I went around the world and judged in many countries, and of course in the United States, and eventually added other breeds to my judging experience.
She has some on her face. Is that she has a piece of straw on her face, or the dog?
What?
The dog. She has straw on her face.
Oh, foxtail.
Yeah, she's in the video now, so I want to make sure she looks as pretty as possible.
Yeah. My country bum.
All right. So tell me, what is the breed standard for the Giant Schnauzer, the AKC standard?
I don't understand the question.
Like in terms of height, weight.
The standard is pretty basic. Strong top line, fairly high tail scent, like 1 o'clock. Good bite, good scissor bite. So that because they're used for police dogs quite a bit, and for search and rescue, and so they need a good bite. In my opinion, the average female weighs around 75 pounds as an adult, and the average male weighs about 95. That doesn't mean that many of them go over. And there are many, many males that weigh up to 125. But it's also the good food that that we give them. So the weight isn't always the correct weight. It's, I think, a lot of dogs in America are obese. Loyal, come here. Mustn't trigger the llamas. So I think that's pretty much average. Now this Loyal, come here. This is a female, and she is about 85, but she's a big female, and I'd say that the average is 75. That does most of the winning in females. In males, people. If you ask me, I say 100 pounds to make it even. You have to stand still.
So today, what work does a breed excel at today in modern society?
What it sells for? Oh, Excel. Well, personally, I'm a fanatic about good health. So in my opinion, when you get a dog and you take good care of him and you feed him correctly and exercise him correctly and he has a good start in life, he should never have to see a veterinarian unless he has an accident, you know, get hit by a car or something. Of course you go to the vet. But there is no health problem in the breed. And to me, that's a big plus when you own a dog. You don't have to worry about hip dysplasia. You don't have to worry about skin problems, or they don't go blind early. They don't go lame. There's bleeding diseases in the Dobermans. There are many, many diseases. But if you ask me outright, I couldn't give you a single disease that I would worry about in giant schnauzer. Not one.
Okay, but like the modern schnauzer, what jobs is it good at doing?
The best, if he has to work, which he should do, he is fantastic in search and rescue. He is excellent in protection. He's really a natural guard dog. I don't encourage people to egg on their personal pets, because these dogs are smart enough when they're adult to know who their enemy is and who is somebody that they know. And so you'll find that by just their big size, black hair, covered eyes, people always think they can't trust a dog that if they can't see their eyes, which is a psychological thing. But and the pricked ears, which it has in common, of course, with the Doberman. So people automatically respect a big black dog. And so you have protection built in already. And the dog is naturally so tuned in to you as a person that he will protect you against against unusual things. If there's an earthquake, I've been told several times by customers in South America that the dogs will literally run outside, in and out, being very restless, and within a few minutes there's a big earthquake. So I've also been told by many people who have children that they'll run into the ocean, grab their baths, their clothing, and drag them to shore, even if they're not in any danger, but the dog considers it dangerous to see a young child swimming outside in the waves, I guess. So they're excellent guard dogs. They're naturals. You don't need to egg them on. If you like to do agility and you like to do Schutzhund, they excel in it. They're what the Germans call them, the professional Schutzhund dog. In other words, the trainer has to know a little bit, because the dog knows more than the trainer. The police likes them very much, but it's also considered an expensive breed. And the police don't want to have a dog where they had to invest in ear crop and grooming regularly. So they will choose a dog, a natural dog like a German Shepherd, for that reason. Otherwise, they would be very popular with the police department. And the same goes for the military. They don't use them because they're considered an expensive breed, even if they would like to use them. And then because they're considered expensive, they're also not used in big scale for guide dog school. They're excellent guide dogs. And we have sold many dogs privately to blind customers who then have them trained personally, and they say they excel in because they can, people who are handicapped, they can lean on them to get up and down, or the dog can pull them up and down, so they have the strength to help handicapped. So it's a very all-around breed. But in return, you have to give them what they need, which is good nutrition, good exercise, keep them nicely groomed, and put in your share, and then you'll have one of the best breeds that most people can ask for that are active. If you sit on the sofa all day and look at TV, don't get a giant schnauzer.
Going back to the AKC standard, is cropping and docking part of the standard? And what are your thoughts on
It calls for cropped ears and short tail, cropped tail in the standard. However, because of Europe having changed their rules the last 15, 20 years and eliminated cropping, it's kind of spilling over to America now. And so Americans are picking it up, but in Europe, it's illegal to crop ears or tails. So all schnauzers have long hanging ears and a long tail. In America, there is no rule for or against, so cropping is still most popular. My personal choice is I love the look of a Doberman or a Great Dane or a Schnauzer with pricked ears. I hate long tails for the simple reason they look and act like a sword. And so if they're the size of your coffee table and they're very friendly, so they're always wagging their tails, particularly violently when they see you, and off comes all the things on your coffee table, all your things on your night table. And you have to worry about them getting in and out of cars. In today's with sliding doors, it's such a convenience not to worry about the tail who so frequently gets caught in car doors. Are the birds singing too loud?
No, that's perfect. Those are vultures, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy. What are they waiting for to die?
No, they're not waiting to die. We have a pit down there where we throw away old bones, and they eat the very little left. Okay. And so they nest all around. But there are farms all over, and so it's basically only, I never see them eat dead things because they never are. I could be a deer that died or something, but that's rare. It's really the pit for the bones. You should see it. It's kind of fun because it almost looks like a boneyard. I always think to myself that when this property goes over to the next generation or two and they're going to dig to find to build a home, they're going to say, oh my God, who died here? It looks like a lot of people or animals died, but it's bones that we bring in, of course.
Is there anything else we should talk about in terms of the breed itself? Because right now I'm about to transition into the pet ownership of the breed.
I think as far as pet owners, and it really is a fact, but I'm sure every breeder says the same thing about their breed. Once you have a schnauzer, you'll never want anything else. But they do require an active lifestyle, and children are great because kids don't stay still. They scream and run and jump in the pool, and the dogs follow them right behind them. So they're very versatile. But do not get a big schnauzer if you don't intend to go for at least 2-3 miles of a walk every day.
In terms of when you bring a schnauzer into your home as a pet owner, what should your expectations be?
When you bring them in, which should be as puppies, everybody should start out with a puppy so the puppy learns your lifestyle. They're very keen on exploring their environment. They'll put their mouths on everything. They'll find your shoes, your socks, your bed. Everything they can find, they'll pick it up and carry it around. And that is just their way of exploring their universe. So they outgrow it. They're not chewers. They don't ruin things to be difficult. They're just curious. So we supply our puppies with bones, regular bones with what we call raw meaty bones, and they love it. They love the taste, and that keeps them busy, and they get nutrition, and they leave your shoes alone.
So in terms of, is there any age limit, or just no matter, so long as the person's active, it doesn't matter how old you are, right?
Their lifespan is, the dog's lifespan is 10 to 12 years as most large breeds, like Dobes and Rottweilers and Schnauzers and Great Danes is a little shorter, the average. However, if you feed them correctly, and you don't let them get fat, and you do exercise them. Many, many of our customers tell us their dog just died and they'd be 15, 16 years old. So they have a long lifespan. The standard Schnauzer, in my opinion, when they first came to the United States, there wasn't one that didn't live to be 15, 16 years old. But like people, they don't eat right, and then that shortens your lifespan.
No, what I'm saying, so like in terms of the owner though, like is there, I mean, obviously you're 80. So.
I think that it's a great, great, great breed for all kids, including little kids, toddlers. I know that you worry about the toddler getting kicked over, but if you laugh and say and applaud the whole situation, the kid is going to laugh and think it's funny too. So it's they're not going to hurt any child except when they come running through the house and the kid happened to be standing there and his balance is not that good. We'll knock him over, but if you make a joke out of it, he'll think it's funny too. So I consider all ages are appropriate for them. I really do. And they're very good people who bring home children, newborns. Even if they've been in the home for a while, they have a tendency to think that, oh, this is valuable to my owner, so I got to guard it. And they will almost immediately take over and guard your little baby.
And with older people,
Elderly people is harder because they also lose their balance. They don't have much good balance when they get older. And so they do have a tendency to, if they jump on them or they lose their balance when they come running. So when I'm 80 and I have 50 giant schnauzers, but I look where I'm going, and that way I don't get knocked over. I got been knocked over several times in my lifetime by the dogs, but now I'm extra careful. That's all.
So, in terms of owning these breeds in a multi-pet home, are they any animal aggression issues or?
They're very, very good with other breeds. Excellent. They're not an aggressive breed at all. You can bring any dog you like here, and our dogs will bark at them, sure, because they're different. But the dog fights are very rare. You'll have two females that are standoff between each other, and they mark it very clearly by putting their heads over each other's shoulder to show dominance. And if that happens, you kind of keep those separate because you don't want to stress them to live with somebody who they feel they have to dominate. But overall, I trust them with everything. I trust them with livestock and horses and rabbits and kittens and they'll chase because that's just fun to run, and they can't help that the cat or the rabbit is running away and they feel obligated to chase it down. But it's not because they want to kill or anything. They just like to play. Loyal? You're not going up there, okay? Good girl. Come here. Come here. You don't like the sun. You're a good girl now.
Uh, How important is socialization and obedience training this breed?
Well, I think it's very important. I think it's great when people take the time to train their dogs and to socialize them and take them with them. A lot of people are taking their dogs to work today. I think it's wonderful. I wish I could have done it, even if flying around the world with a dog wouldn't have been a very smart thing. But they like all dogs, they need to be well socialized. But what I also think is very important is when young puppies are 7, 8 weeks old and the owner comes to get them or the buyer comes to get them, that dog has only learned very little socializing from his mother and his littermates, but he hasn't learned to speak dog language yet. He hasn't learned how to cope with big, strange dogs. And so that part of socializing is lacking in many, many pet owners. So what we do, we keep our pups till we don't let them go before 10 weeks, preferably 16 weeks. And they are then socialized with other puppies, with big dogs, with old dogs, and that will teach them things more than a person can. And that, and the main thing is, I feel that they speak what the, yo, lawyer, come here. I feel they speak a dog language. And so many dogs don't speak their own language. And that's a handicap. So they come to the dog park and they can't speak their own language. And then they get frightened of the other dogs or they get aggressive with the other dog. A giant schnauzer like ours, it'll just trot through the park like, hi there, everybody. And I think that it's just completely natural. And why should you attack? There's no danger here. I don't have to protect myself. But then there are dogs in the park that will attack. And if you have a well-socialized dog, he's not going to fight right back. He's going to stand there and say, are you an idiot? Leave me alone or you're going to be in trouble. And then it's up to him whether it pursues into a big fight or not. But dogs have to learn to speak to each other too and respect each other. And it's so much lacking. You know, people walk a little miniature schnauzer down the street on a leash. And now there is a big dog, a Doberman, across the street. Stay. And so he has to, of course, bark to, for many reasons, mainly. I think he wants to go and say hello and say, listen, I'm over here. So, you know, watch out, because I'm a big, strong guy and I can kill you, you know. So, of course, the dog on the other side of the street totally ignores it. But the mini, for some reason, gets so frustrated because he never is allowed to make that introduction or meet the other dog. So he starts turning this anger, which builds and builds and builds. So if he ever gets with another dog, he'll run right at it and attack it. And then you'll tell me, well, he doesn't like other dogs. If it was my dog and my minis, I would take them off the leash, let them run up and say hello, and they sniff each other's rear to introduce themselves. And then they'll probably walk away like that wasn't any fun. So it's this thing of forcing them not to be able to say hello to other dogs is very negative to a dog's psyche. I'm sure you have that problem with pit bulls, don't you?
Yeah.
People worry about them, but that's because they're held back and right. Then they become dangerous.
Right.
That's how you train a Schnauzer, you know?
Yeah.
If I want to make this one nasty, all you have to do is start wagging around with your stuff there and act a little threatening.
Right.
And I'm going to hold them and say, good girl, good girl,
yeah.
Get him.
Right.
And that's how I build up his confidence, like
right.
You're a bad guy right. And you should be attacked.
Right.
Stop. If you don't go to the llamas, you can go there. No!
So my next question goes into, let's talk about, we had a great conversation about diet. What's the best thing to feed a giant schnauzer? And I'm sure you would argue you would feed any dog this.
All our dogs, every single one of them, gets nothing but raw, meaty bones. And that means they can eat like turkey. You could take the whole turkey and cut off the neck for one meal and a couple of thighs for the next meal and the carcass, the body, chest cavity for the third meal. So then he gets everything he needs. Then you need to give him some organ meats like liver and heart, gizzards. And then we recommend that you give them a can of sardines in olive oil once or twice a week. We recommend eggs, raw eggs, excellent. And chicken, and then they can eat steak, of course. So it's a matter of shopping. If you start shopping, you can buy 40 pounds of chicken for half the price of commercial dog food, and it's 100% more nutritious.
What about, so with the chicken, I pull the skin off the chicken. Do you know anything about
that? No, leave the skin.
Leave the skin?
Mm-hmm. Skin is actually healthy. There's a lot of nutrition between the skin and the white meat.
I was doing my research. I saw something about pancreatitis, though, with chicken fat.
Well, the problem with chicken today is not the skin or anything. The problem is that the chickens that you buy yourself and eat and you give to your dog, those chickens are so, they're sitting in cages and they're force-fed more or less, not force-fed, but they're fed only one thing. And then to be able to keep them healthy, because it's such an unnatural life for a chicken to just sit still and eat and grow, they put antibiotics in there. And so the food you eat is full of antibiotics. So you eat the food they eat have antibiotics. Now it gets into the meat, now you eat it. And so if you're really going to be a good feeder and really be careful, you should look to what you eat, what are they eating? Like, what is the cow eating, whose steak you are eating, and whose milk you're drinking, and the butter you are eating? Did that cow stand in a cow lot with 10,000 other cows, or did he go out on a nice pasture and eat grass, and now you have nutritious butter, nutritious milk, and nutritious meat? So that's going to be the next in nutrition. You'll find that people are going to demand that the meat, milk, butter, everything comes from animals that have been eating well also.
So I know we kind of already talked about this, but let me just, this is another question I have here. There are no health issues facing this breed?
In my opinion, there used to be hip dysplasia, like in all big breeds. Personally, I have completely eliminated it by nutrition. You are what you eat. If you're going to eat good bones, their bone marrow, what's in that bone marrow is so full of minerals, you can't even replicate it. And if the dog gets all that, he gets they're carnivores. They don't chew or grind food like you and I do. So they call carnivores, and they have big teeth, and they have these big fangs, and all they're good for is to catch and crush and kill and rip food off their kill. So now that's what a carnivore does, whether it's a fox or a coyote or a, and if you think that your dog is not a carnivore and he has to have disinfected meat that's been cut up for him or ground up for him or all these things that people do to food, you're making a big disservice to your dog, because he needs to use the muscles in his mouth. And that way, if you have healthy teeth, clean teeth, most likely you have a healthy body. It's so that's your first step to in the maintenance of a carnivore. Now, people will say, come here. People will say, you know, I don't like, I don't think it's healthy. They can get E. coli from meat. And I'm always thinking to myself, so you are buying chicken and meat in the grocery store and you're eating it because you're not worried about E. coli because you cook out, you kill off the E. coli. So you bought tainted meat to begin with. I don't understand that. If you don't, you know, to think that you have to cook something to make it safe is completely, it's so off base. I don't understand it. I don't feel it's exactly the opposite. They now know from health purposes, the more raw food you eat, the healthier you are. And that's true of fish like sushi, it's true of vegetables, and it's true of salads, everything. The minute you cook it, you kill the enzymes. I think the llama, she's just lost interest in the llamas.
She might be trying to chill in that shade.
Yeah.
So you want to talk about the Skansen diet?
The Skansen diet?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. First, I'm going to tell you about Skansen. Skansen, it's a very famous place in Stockholm, Sweden. It's a whole island right in the middle of Stockholm, the city of Stockholm. And they have brought down to this island for several hundred years now cattle, pigs, pheasants, ducks. And so the people, the young families in Stockholm, they bring their kids to Skansen, which is that island is called, or that place. And they bring them there so they get to see what a cow looks like and a horse looks like and the barn looks like in the old times and how you milk. And the kids love that. And I was one of those kids that were born and brought up in Stockholm. And my parents took me there. And the biggest thing we used to, when the parents said, what do you want to do? We all say, we want to go to Skansen, we want to go to Skansen. Just like today they say, we want to go to Disneyland here. We wanted to go to Skansen. So when I came to this country and I was going and I started living here in Sebastopol, I had to choose a name for my dogs and the place. And then I thought, well, this is going to be Skansen in America. And that's how I got the name. And Skansen means fortress, if you translate it into English.
And so the Skansen diet?
And the Skansen diet is raw, meaty bones. Like one dog like her size, she would get a big turkey neck, a handful of organ meats, and an egg. That's what she would eat on a daily basis. The good things, the positive things for which people always mention is when you feed raw, and the bones, of course, they always get a big bone with meat on so they can chew and they leave all the other stuff alone and it's safe. They have very small stools, so it's very little to pick up. And that means, of course, that most of it is utilized by the body of the animal. And it's convenient for you.
Let's talk about the cleaning, the grooming, and the coat of the giant schnauzer.
They're very, very low maintenance, in my own opinion. They need to be groomed about three times a year. Most people will clip them down, leave the leg hair and the beard and the eyebrows, which gives them their special look. So if you give them a bath every 2 months or every 3 months, give them a haircut, they're always, always going to look good. And everybody can do it themselves. And because grooming today, going to a grooming shop is quite expensive, just one visit at the groomer will pay for a clipper. And you get to sell one of those electric clippers, and then you clip your own dog. You may make mess up the first couple of times, and it looks a little jagged, but it's fun, and you're going to get an expert at it, and you're going to take pride in doing it. And so the grooming is really easy, as long as you're willing to either cut the hair yourself or pay a grooming shop.
Now, in terms of this, there's a lot of hair. So is this would you consider this to be an inside dog or outside dog, the giant schnauzer?
They want to be with you. So if you want to be inside, they want to be inside. If you want to be outside, they want to be outside. It's not the kind of dog you just lock out in your backyard and you sit inside and enjoy your cool air conditioner. They really are people dog. They really would like to climb right inside your body. They just want to be with you 24 hours.
All right, so that's pretty much it. Is there anything that you wanted to mention or?
No, I just, I will say one thing about the breed, which I find interesting, is it's a very intelligent breed. And I know everybody thinks their dog is intelligent, and most dogs are. But they are intelligent in the sense that they pick up on your emotions. So they make a very good companion. You can cry hugging them, you can laugh hugging them, you can, all your emotions you can act out with your dog, which is a good source for children who needs somebody they can cry on and talk to. I find that the breed is very intellectual in the sense that people who are successful, businessmen for instance, they are very much drawn to this breed. I know that Castro had three of them when he was young. I know many film stars who have them or had them when they were younger. The people who are highly driven and kind of the A profile love this breed because the breed is also highly driven.
So the last question is just to basically give a conclusion, kind of like what you just were doing, but just in terms of just as, you know, if you want to summarize your experience with the breed, any special thoughts, and then just a sort of call to action that for anyone who may want to, who may be considering this breed as their next pet.
Okay. As a conclusion, I think it's a magnificent breed to look at. When you walk down the street, you're going to get attention. If you don't want attention and you don't want to tell everybody and his mother how much you love your dog and what breed it is, because people will actually stop the cars and ask you, what is that magnificent dog? So they're a magnet for their look. And a lot of people like that, of course. But if you have a wife at home with a bunch of kids and you travel and you worry about her leaving her alone with a kid, you couldn't get a better breed because they scare the daylight out of burglars and everybody else that don't belong in your house simply by their big size, their black, their pricked ears, and you can't see their eyes. And so it's a natural guard dog without any fear of really harming anybody. I have to tell you this story. It was an admiral that retired up in Santa Rosa 50 years ago, and he came here to buy a dog because he now retired. And he said, all my requirement is I want a big giant schnauzer, but he has to like my cat. And I said, oh, okay. Take the puppy home. If you have any problem, then bring him back. That's all I can say, because if your cat is nice, dog will be nice. It's kind of both, from both angles. So I took the dog, and then he called me about 6 months later, and he told me that every home on his block had been burglarized except his, because his black giant was lying around in the backyard. So they burglarized every home except his. So he said, you know, he did his job. I think that's a good story about what a good guard dog is.
You know, can you tell me about the facility? This could be, I didn't get into it, but tell me about the whole, the ranch and all that.
Yeah, I came to California in 1960, as I was based in San Francisco as a flight attendant, and as a base, we would fly around the world. And I loved animals from the beginning, so I had a horse, and it was in a stable in Marin County, and of course they took good care of it when I was flying. So then one day I decided it was kind of expensive to feed, to pay for this stabling, so why couldn't I just have a little plot, like an acre and a little house, and my horse could graze, and I could feed it myself, because they don't need to have an attendant 24 hours. And so I started looking for property, and went, because the property was very expensive, close to the city, the further out you went, like Sonoma County was cheap. You could buy an acre for $2,000 that today is $70,000 to $80,000 minimum to get good acreage. So it turned out to be a good investment, on top of being the perfect place to live, close to the city, close to airports, close to shopping, and still living with the birds and the bees, as they say. And we have llamas, of course, to keep the grass short. They haven't done a good job this year because the grass has grown faster than they can eat it because of all our rain. But I bought 100 acres and have been here for the last 50 years now. And the dogs love it. It's safe. They can run free all day long. And I love it. I love trees and singing birds and nature.
So aside from the dogs, you just have the llamas and the dogs here?
The llamas, you want to go and take?
No, I'm sorry. You have the llamas and the dogs. That's the only animals you have on the property, or you have?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I used to have cattle, goats, sheep, but cattle is very hard on the ground. Their feet stampede the ground, and you need somebody to cut the grass. And goats are kind of adventurous. They'll run off to the neighbor and eat all their plants. They don't respect fencing like the llamas do. Little 4-foot fence, and they'll never go leave it.
How many dogs do you have here?
I keep 50 dogs, 50 adult. And then we have puppies, and we have a waiting list for our schnauzers of 6 months to a year now. So if you want a giant, you have to let us know in plenty of time. But with each puppy's sale goes a lot of education, because we want your puppy to be super healthy, and we want to help you every step of the way. And if you're into nutrition and good health for yourself and your dog, you come to the right place. If you think a dog should just be thrown a cup of dry food in the backyard and be left there, then don't get a giant schnauzer.
Very cool. So I want to thank you so much for taking the time to do this interview. I'm going to stop now, and then I guess I can run around. We can shoot around the property.
Yes.
Okay, mm-hmm. 1 second. Let me just...
You should go and shoot the llamas.
Yeah, I will. Let me just get the microphone.